Ooh, do you got it? Do you got it? Is it on? Why won't you catch my face at all? What's up, sons? It's Blind Rod with Savatech once again, and today I'm excited to bring you guys my overclocking guide for the AMD Ryzen 9 3900X. Thanks to a little guy named Roger over at a great company that he owns called XGamer PC, I was honored enough to pick up a Ryzen 9 3900X from them for testing purposes. While I do have to return it, we were allowed to overclock and do all that sort of stuff. And we have it in the system right now that I'm going to be doing the demonstration on for you. First of all, there's going to be the disclaimer. You will void your warranty in some cases for overclocking, and I'm not responsible for any damage you may due to any components in your system. That's all the non-fun stuff. Let's get into the fun stuff here. So I have been looking at what other people have been achieving with their overclocks, along with comparing gaming benchmarks with an all-core overclock or just using Precision Boost if you have an X model Zen 2 chip or CPU. And there are quite a few important notes. But if you're really going for the EPIN of the highest all-core overclock and you're looking at getting those high Cinebench numbers, then that's what this video is going to be focused on. We spent the first 6 to 7 hours with this chip just purely benchmarking, overclocking, and running, well, not even benchmarking, basically essentially just overclocking and trying to achieve the highest score in Cinebench R20 that we possibly could. Now, while we didn't get to the top of the leaderboards on what I use for a benchmarking of how good I'm overclocking a particular part is hardwarebot.org, we only got to second place. We did come out pretty good for being on air, as that was on a custom loop that he was using. However, also from other overclocking statistics I've seen on this chip, it does look like we had to push our voltage a little bit higher than the average to go ahead and meet that. If you don't mind though, before we start the video, check out the link to XGamer PC down in the description if you are interested in any boutique systems. He does custom loop builds, etc. You can also purchase GPU upgrades and things of that sort as well. So check out the website down below. Let's get into it, huh? I'm going to move us on over to the overclocking system. Okie dokie, so first things first, you'll notice that we are in the BIOS. Yes, you can use Ryzen Master to overclock, and I have been hearing some rumblings around that that is the best way to overclock. I found that getting our scores, we did it in the BIOS and we had no changes. There is an important caveat to that. Depending on the motherboard, as far as I understand right now, if you pick up a Gigabyte motherboard, the voltage application that you're setting in the BIOS is not working correctly or functioning correctly. To verify this with anything that you have, make sure you get an application that can read the voltages. Hardware Monitor works great, Hardware Info, CPU-Z, and there are a few others. You can leave your favorite monitoring tool down in the description below. And yes, there's more than one way to skin a cat, so if you think I'm doing it wrong and your way is better, also let me know in the comment section below. I'm always willing to learn. So the first thing we did, of course, was update the BIOS. There were already 4 BIOS updates for this ASUS Tough motherboard. We have the Tough Gaming X570 Plus Wi-Fi, and there are already 4 BIOS versions revisions before we even got this board this week, which is insane. So the BIOS version at this time is 7010 is what we're working with here. And this is what is the easy mode. In the easy mode, there's not a ton you can do. You have easy system tuning if you want to mess with that. I wouldn't recommend it. You do have QFan control here, and you have your boot priorities. You also see up here that you'll get a peek at your motherboard and CPU temperature and a peek at your CPU voltage. But what we're going to be taking a look at is going to be pressing F7 and in the advanced mode. Now, if we come into the advanced mode, you're going to bump over to AI Tweaker, and this is where you can make all of your settings changes. Now, what I'm going to show you guys here is what I feel confident in showing you will work on 99% of the systems. While your mileage may vary, this is a conservative overclock with a pretty high voltage that's going to, you're going to be able to, this is what I would call quick settings, essentially. It should work, and as long as your cooling is good or mildly good, even the stock cooler should be able to handle this, then you aren't going to see any issues. Now, on my particular setup right now, we have a Noctua NH-D15. I would recommend, at the very least, if you're already spending $500 on a CPU, at getting a really good air cooler like this one, or of course going with a custom loop, which I was going to try to attempt to do, but I was missing two barbs and we are running a little short on time. That being said, or time with the 3900X, that is. We have the AI overclock tuner. You're going to have auto and DOCP. What we're really looking for is DOCP. This is going to apply what's known as, on the Intel side, XMP. So if you come down here, it's going to be able to read the XMP profile. Once again, that's kind of an Intel thing, and set all those settings. In this case, we have a set of Corsair Dominator Platinum clocked at 3200 megahertz with 16 CAS latency. Pretty loose timings there, and it'll set it to 1.35 volts. We're going to talk about memory overclocking on Ryzen probably in another video. Just make sure that you have this set to whatever your memory is rated at. And keeping in mind that one-to-one Infinity Fabric, which is something I learned is very important, is actually only up to 3600 megahertz as confirmed by AMD on a Reddit thread, and not the 3733 that they had put on their initial slides. If you notice that you have, like, you're running at 3733 and your benchmark or your Cinebench seems lower than what you see my Cinebench is at, for example, bump to 3600 megahertz or below and you will probably see that score go up. In fact, in media creation, etc., you will also see this, things like Adobe and so on and so forth. So it's really more important for me to clarify with you guys that anything over 3733 is not one-to-one currently, and it will suffer from a degradation in performance up to, from what I saw in render times, 20%. So 3600 megahertz or below is going to be the requirement here. Moving on, we'll go over that in a completely different video. Let's talk about my basic settings here. We have the CPU core ratio at 4.3 gigahertz. This is, or well, we have the CPU clocked at it. We have the CPU core ratio at 43. The highest I've been able to get on my particular chip was 43.75 at 1.48 volts. And our max temperature during that time was 84 degrees Celsius. And we are pushing the voltage pretty high. Now, the voltage we have pretty high as well. And some of you guys might not agree with me. I'd be curious what you're comfortable with on max voltage. The max voltage that we have set here right now is 1.45 volts. At 4.3 gigahertz, what you'll notice is that, at least in my case, in some circumstances, depending on like how your how well your chips bend and so on and so forth, bumping the voltage up or bumping the voltage down will increase or decrease performance. And you're going to want to play with your voltage actually at this 4.3 gigahertz. While I can pretty much guarantee at 1.45 volts, you're going to hit that 4.3 gigahertz almost in all scenarios, your score in Cinebench might be lower, and that might be due to your voltage more than actually due to any of your clocks or anything along those lines. What we found while testing in the live stream, which I'll leave linked up in the corner above here, is that at 1.4 volts, we scored lower than at 1.45 volts. So in our case in particular, when we were trying to get that perfect kind of mix, 1.45 volts gave us a higher score in Cinebench. Now, you do have your SoC voltage. At this point, really, SoC voltage, you're going to want to change not so much for CPU overclocking, but more for memory overclocking. We'll talk about that in the later. Your max SoC voltage, I would recommend at 1.25. Previously for Ryzen. That being said, now things seem to have changed. It's interesting that it auto, it sets it to 1.25, which in the past for a lot of people was considered quite high. And I think that's also why you see the onboard motherboard fans on almost all of the X570 series, the Tough, the Gigabyte, pretty much all of them are running that sort of stuff, that that sort of cooling option. And we'll go over that in a motherboard review. So if you're interested in any of these new parts, definitely hit the subscribe and we'll go through all that later. Now the DOCP pulled the RAM voltage from the XMP profile and applied it here at 1.35. If you were going to be overclocking memory, once again, you'd want to come in here and probably go up to 1.45, max 1.5 volts. So these are the basic settings that you're going to be going over. Okay, so another place that you can check some more overclock settings is going over to the advanced menu, at least on the ASUS X570 motherboards, and coming down to AMD overclocking. In this menu, it will force you to accept, and then once you're in here, you're going to have some more stuff you can tweak. One of the cool things is you do have DDR and frequency and timings and infinity fabric frequency and dividers. Basically, this is what we're referring to on one-to-one. So for example, if you were having issues getting that one-to-one and you wanted to actually overclock further than that 3600 megahertz, you would probably want to come into here and see if you can bump it up. So for example, I guess 3600 would be what? It would be 1900 megahertz. Is that right? Yeah. So if you're going to try to overclock your memory above that, you'd want to come in here and set the infinity fabric frequency and dividers. Basically, this is going to be half of whatever the total memory frequency will be at the end of the day. So that's how that works. And I haven't played with it enough, so I don't know enough about it at this time. I definitely would like to learn though, so leave some comments down below. We do have precision boost overdrive options that you can turn on and all of that. But if you're manually overclocking, we're going to be ignoring that one. There is the SoC voltage that you can adjust from here. And then your VDDP and your VDDG. And the uncore overclock mode you can enable or disable. So we have it enabled currently for what we've been doing. And then those are some additional overclocking options that are available on X570. That I didn't see at least on first-gen X370. And I only had a brief moment with the X470 motherboard, so hopefully we'll be able to play with X470 a little bit more and get a better comparison for you guys. But that's going to be it for overclocking in the ASUS BIOS. You'll come over to exit and click save changes and reset. Okay, so let's talk about the second way you can overclock. You can overclock from the operating system. Now if you're going to be overclocking from the operating system with Ryzen Master, I still would recommend that you find the settings within the Ryzen Master software and then go back into your BIOS and make those setting changes. Of course, there is some additional tweaking that, for example, the X570 Tough motherboard doesn't have that the Ryzen Master will have, at least more easily accessible, because you can do per core still in the BIOS. Speaking of that, let's hop into Ryzen Master and we'll show you guys around here a little bit. So of course the warning is going to come in and let you guys know that basically you're voiding warranty, etc. and so on, and it will force you to accept it. Once you're in Ryzen Master, you can only overclock in the profiles. So you're going to click down to the profile you want to edit, and then these are all of your options. We're going to click on manual. And then we're going to be able to adjust all of our core clocks and then down here, the CPU voltage. Now, this is when we were trying to hit 4.4 gigahertz and I was unable to do that. Like I said, we are able to hit 4.375. Now, one of the easiest ways to navigate through this is going to be clicking on one of the cores that you want to edit, and you can just go up and down on the arrow keys, which I find to be the easiest way, because then you can go through and set all of these as you want. Like I said before, we're going to be at 4.3 gigahertz on all cores and then at 1.4 volts minimum. For me, saying that it'll probably work would be 1.4 volts and best performance, or guaranteed to probably work 99% of the time, would be 1.45 volts. Do I recommend running that 24/7? Maybe not, but if you're trying to get a high score in Cinebench, then I think you'll be perfectly fine. So here, that's basically the rundown here. There is a lot more versatility right off the bat than just doing a single core. I have heard of people doing 4.4 gigahertz on half of the cores and 4.3 on the other half of the cores. I haven't personally tested this yet, but maybe we'll get a chance to do that in the near future. You can then adjust your CPU voltage and then come down here and click apply or apply and test to make sure it's stable and so on and so forth. At this point, let's go ahead and show you guys the results that we got. So if we come into here, we're going to take a look at our Cinebench R20 scores. And we have our stock score here, our two stock scores. One was stock completely at 2133 megahertz. If we take a look at this score, we only got a 7004. Now, turning on the DOCP, also known as XMP, we went all the way up to a Cinebench score of 7146. But it does get really, really interesting as we start overclocking. At 4.3 gigahertz, if I can find it here. So curious enough, I didn't actually even capture a score at 4.3 gigahertz. We have one at 4.35 gigahertz. And on this, we scored a 7,633. And this was at the 1.4 volts. And then, like I said, we did crank the voltage up. And when we cranked the voltage up at that same clock rate is when we started seeing a pretty significant bump in score as well, up to 7,862. And our highest score was 7,878. This was at 1.45 volts, as you can see here in CPU-Z, and it was at 4.375 gigahertz. And this one is also verified on hardwarebot.org. And was in second place as of yesterday, but probably has bumped down a little bit as people start getting them underwater in LN2. We will fall pretty short there. You can also see here that I have my memory at basically 35, 33 megahertz. I couldn't hit 3600, but for that one-to-one, I was able to hit 35, 33, and that did help us out with this particular score. Like I said, max temperatures during these runs was 84 degrees Celsius. All right, so that's going to wrap up the video for today. I hope it helped you guys figure out how to overclock and basically a good starting point. Like I said, the starting point for at least if you're trying to get a high score in Cinebench is going to be 1.45 volts with decent cooling at 4.3 gigahertz and then start tweaking from there. You can bump up 25 megahertz there just one by one until you get to essentially whatever your max clock is and keep testing and trying to get the Cinebench run. Of course, if you're going for a 24/7 stable overclock, I do think that would be stable 24/7, but running your processor that hot might not be something that you're okay with. There's a lot of other conversations we can have about processor degradation and so on and so forth in a different video, and I'll let you guys argue about that in the comment section today, but that's not what I want to talk about personally. So at this point, like I said, the Noctua NHD15, is it worth overclocking the 3900X? So after extensive testing, seeing that we have the precision boost on the 3900X and seeing that the in-game performance increases are not that good, if you're going for anything outside of benchmarking, so anything outside of Geekbench or anything outside of Cinebench or high overclocking scores for multi-threaded higher overclocking, I don't think overclocking is worth it. And the reason is because with the 3900X, and this is probably different for the non-X versions, but for the X versions of Zen 2, the precision boost is working very, very well. And you're going to see more performance benefits out of that, depending on the application you run, than you would out of a 24/7 all-core overclock. So for day-to-day purposes, I would actually just say the best performance is precision boost turned on, a good memory overclock, which is more important, which we'll talk about in another video, and just leaving it as is and running with it. we'll talk about later, maybe a little bit, the is it worth upgrading from a Ryzen 7 2700 to a Ryzen 9 3900X even. I think you guys will find that video interesting. If you're interested in that, hit the subscribe button. Like I said, we're also going to talk about the X570 motherboard. We have more to talk about with the 5700XT. In particular, we have the anniversary edition in here now. So we're going to compare that to the non-anniversary edition. And I'm super excited to have all this content and be able to bring it out to you guys. I will see you next Tuesday.